Hi everyone, welcome to Hub Bites. I'm Sanil Rege, consultant psychiatrist. Today I'm going to be talking about the difference between two antidepressants that are commonly prescribed. Venlafaxine, which is also known as EFFEXOR, versus Desvenlafaxine, the trade name PRISTIQ. Now there are some other trade names as well, but we're going to focus on EFFEXOR versus PRISTIQ or Venlafaxine versus Desvenlafaxine. Now, both of these are classified as SNRIs, which basically mean serotonin, norepinephrine, or noradrenaline reuptake inhibitors. What that means is, we've done a video on this channel, so do have a listen to it in more detail. But essentially, what they do is they block the SERT, the protein that takes serotonin into the presynaptic neuron. By blocking it, there's lots of serotonin available in the synaptic cleft to act on the postsynaptic receptors. Similarly, they block what's called NART or NET, norepinephrine transporter. So therefore, there's lots of noradrenaline available in the synaptic cleft for its action. So when we think about it, you've got serotonin, you've got noradrenaline. But what's different about these two, now, desvenlafaxine is nothing but a metabolite of venlafaxine. Venlafaxine is metabolized into what's called ODV, which is O-desmethylvenlafaxine. So let's cover venlafaxine first. You see, venlafaxine is really a dual agent in a way. And what I mean by that is that the serotonin, norepinephrine, or noradrenaline reuptake inhibition happens sequentially and is dose dependent, which means that when I initiate venlafaxine at a lower dose of 37.5 and go up to 75 milligrams. At 75 milligrams, it has a 30-fold greater affinity to SERT. Compare that to desvenlafaxine, which has only a 10-fold affinity to SERT. So we get a lot more serotonin inhibition with venlafaxine at 75, and it sequentially rises the serotonin. Now, when does the norepinephrine aspects come into the equation as the doses go higher? And a paper by Debonnel showed that this norepinephrine activity starts occurring at doses of 225 and above. And that's why at 375 milligrams, and in some cases 425 milligrams, higher doses that are prescribed, that's when you start getting this norepinephrine activity. But the issue with venlafaxine is that you can't just get a norepinephrine activity without increasing the serotonin. So as the doses go up, you get quite significant serotonin and quite significant norepinephrine. And this is reflected in the side effect profile. So therefore, in the initial stages, it has all the side effects of an SSRI, sexual dysfunction, the anxiety, sleep disturbances, all of emotional blunting, all of those aspects can happen with venlafaxine, the serotonin. But as you go higher, the norepinephrine aspects come in. So higher blood pressure, sustained high blood pressure is a side effect that can occur with increased noradrenaline. But you also have the other epinephrine side effects, such as dry mouth, constipation, and sometimes increased anxiety. So note that you're getting quite a double whammy of this, and therefore the side effect profile can be an issue when it comes to venlafaxine. Now, desvenlafaxine, on the other hand, does not have this sequential effect. It is an SNRI right from the start, from 50 milligrams all the way. Higher doses are also prescribed, and there's good evidence in major depressive disorder that doses of 200 milligrams and 400 milligrams are efficacious and well tolerated. Of course, the side effects such as blood pressure needs to be monitored, all of those come into the equation. But essentially, the purpose of this video was to highlight that these are quite different. Even though venlafaxine is classified as an SNRI, that depends on the dose. And both of these agents do provide dopamine. Venlafaxine does it at much higher doses. Desvenlafaxine does it, of course, at the lower dose a little bit, and then as you go higher also provides dopamine. But in its side effect profile, you can see you're getting this double whammy with venlafaxine lots of serotonin, and as you go up, you continue to get the serotonin, and noradrenaline goes up as well. So therefore, when it in clinical practice, venlafaxine is evidence-based in not only major depressive disorder, but also, say for example, in anxiety disorders, social phobia, in premenstrual dysphoric disorder, and that's because at lower doses, it has properties of an SSRIs, and SSRIs are also evidence-based in these conditions. Whilst desvenlafaxine predominantly is evidence-based in major depressive disorder. Now, there's some evidence that in pain, etc., it may provide that benefit because of its stronger norepinephrine activity. So I hope that this gives you an understanding that these are two different agents and should be therefore thought about appropriately in clinical practice in relation to the choice. So I hope that you found this video useful. Thank you so much for supporting our channel. Until next time, take care and stay safe. Bye-bye.